Ladies and gentlemen, this is the last session of the morning, so as I'm standing between you and lunch, I'll try to keep it very lively and straight to the point. I would invite my fellow panelists to join me on stage, and as they come here, I present them. We're having Dr. Ahmed Al-Kazmi, Director General Planning and Studies at the Ministry of Health. Mr. Walid Al-Murshed, Head of IFC Saudi Arabia and Principal of MENA. The IFC, as you know, is the private sector arm of the World Bank. Then we'll have Dr. Amin Mukarzel, who is president of Louvre Hotel Group, which has among its brands the Golden Tulip, which I'm sure all of you know. Then Mr. Anwar Al-Jabri, who is chief executive officer of ONIC, and my former colleague. We were just sitting next to each other. Our office were contiguous until a few days ago, so it's for me, it's a welcome occasion to see a great friend. And then, last but not least, Mr. Hussam Al-Nabani, who is Vice President, Implementation Support and Follow-Up Unit at TANFEED Program. I don't know if the guys down there have can put my presentation on stage. So I just want to give you a quick overview on PPP, because sometimes people don't have clear what this is, and so I will devote 5 minutes to clarify some of the issues. So essentially, private-public partnership are an alternative to the typical standard procurement procedure in providing for public services or public infrastructure. And what is the key element here is the shifting of the burden from the government books onto the private sector. Now, I know it sounds a strange question, but why would you want to do that? Why do you want to have the private sector to be involved in the provision of public services or public infrastructure? Well, this has to do with the way, and you know, we have to be aware of this point, of the way in which government accounting works and why it is different from the from a private company. If a private company, say, builds a new headquarters, in the first year, among its cost, it will only include the amortization of the new building. If a government builds a new ministry, the entire amount of the cost of that ministry goes into 1 year. In essence, governments work on a cash basis, and that penalizes the construction of infrastructure because it goes directly into the deficit of a particular year, and it's not spread along 10 or 20 years as it happens for private firms. So there is this inconsistency between the public and private accounting that makes PPP enticing for the government. But there are other issues, obviously, because you know, the way PPP are built introduce a degree of discipline and transparency in the working of governments. We have several ways of actually designing this PPP. It can be, for example, a highway, okay? The government decides where it should be built, expropriates lands, then gives the task to a private company to build and operate it. The private company issues bonds, and the bonds are repaid by the toll paid by users of the highway, by car and by trucks. So this is something where the government only has a limited role in launching the initiative and then leaves the private sector to operate it. There is another scheme by which, for example, the government wants to build a hospital, in which case it gives the task to a private company. The company builds the hospital, and then the government pays a fee for the rent of the building, and sometimes for certain services, like, I don't know, food or cleaning. And in that case, the government remains into the scheme. Then there are other schemes that are also considered PPP, classified as PPP, like, for example, the air traffic control contract, but it's less widespread. So, let me go essentially to the benefits of PPP. The benefits come from three specific sources: the specific ownership structure, the optimal bundling of services, and the appropriate risk sharing between those that can actually bear it, i.e. the government and the private sector. Often, the public entity is the ultimate risk bearer, for example, on the financial side. A typical case has been the Eurotunnel, where the private company that was running it defaulted several times, and then the government had to intervene. So this is a key issue to understand and to figure out correctly in the design of the PPP structure. So to summarize what I've been saying, a PPP has three main features: a long-term contractual obligation between a private partner and a public entity. The private counterparty arranges the financing, so issues the bonds in the market or gets loans by the bank, and takes care of the various phases of construction. The third element is a risk-sharing agreement between the private and public entity. In other words, if things go wrong or if they don't go according to a plan, who is responsible for what? And this is very important. Now, PPP generally inject a degree of discipline into the working of the government, because you have to be accountable to investors who put the money to finance. And remember, the money that you ask ask from the market for a PPP is more costly than the money a government asks from the market, because almost all the time, the government has a higher rating than any other entity in the country. So in general, you have to pay more, but you get a better service. So you have to understand that PPP are not a panacea, are not the solution to every problem, are not the solution to any possible provision of services of infrastructure, but entail a trade-off between higher borrowing costs and better efficiency in construction, risk sharing, and running of the public service or the infrastructure. So with this, I stop, and I ask my fellow panelists to give us their experience, to share with us their experience in PPP in this part of the world. I'll start from my immediate right. So if you can please tell us what you think, if you have, what are your thoughts on the benefits, the trouble, the trade-offs of PPP in this part of the world?
So I work at the ISFU, the Implementation Support and Follow-Up Unit. And part of ISFU looks at PPP as an alternative methodology, or if you like, a vehicle to assist the government or governments, generally speaking, in meeting their plans in terms of public services. So indeed, we've been working very closely with the Ministry of Finance to further develop these areas, and we look forward to attracting both internal as well as foreign investment that may be of interest to projects under the structure of PPP.
Do you have any experience you want to share with us?
Thank you. First of all, since I come from the health sector, and nowadays it's this issue of PPP is a hot issue on the table, especially for the health sector in Oman. What I can see in one of the things that we believe in health sector is that 10% of the GDP, which is one of the lowest. On the other side, we are considered one of the efficient health system. So if we look into PPP as a tool of financing the system, we should not compromise the quality on that area. Now, Minister of Health is the first ministry which started in 1984 or 85, giving the non-clinical services to the private. So since 1985, all non-clinical, like laundries, caterings, every non-clinical, it's already to the private. We purchase the service.
For they the are clinical, outsourcing.
Outsourcing, yes. Outsourcing. But for clinical part, health is really very unique. And we should be considering it not like other services. It's we are under World Health Organization regulation, especially with the primary health care, which is all the services like the immunization, women and health child. This is the leadership of this, either for providing the service, and so should be the government, the governance, and so on. But the room is there for PPP. Our vision, really, for health vision, for Oman 2040 in health vision, at least to have like 50% of the financing is governmental and 50% is private. How we do it, through the partnership, through the privatization, but we are taking it gradually, but we are on the way to really do that.
But you know, for somebody who has not, an extensive experience in the health service, in healthcare, it's natural to think that arrangements already exist between, say, private insurance and hospitals. So can you adopt those same arrangements in the provision of healthcare through the public sector, but by buying services from private clinics?
As I said, we these are all now under discussion. We started not only the non-clinical, but we started the clinical, like the renal dialysis. we are also buying from the private the service mm-hmm. itself. But for the new projects which we are really planning to have the private sector, like functioning, the functions is private, but the building is a government. Mm-hmm. The running, the what we call running the services is a private operation, is mm-hmm. a private. It's as I said, we are not in the Ministry of Health against this, but we are studying it in deep. And all our, what we call, targets is really to have a sustainable financing for the health system and also for a high quality. Now, we believe that if we have a strong private sector in Oman health sector, whether it's purely private or through the partnership, this will raise the quality of the governmental hospitals and, mm-hmm. And so on. Now we cannot have benchmarking.
Yeah.
We are only benchmarking with ourselves inside the box.
Sure.
But if you have like a strong private sector, health sector, at least we can, we believe that the quality in the governmental sector should be raised. And this is really one of the, what we call a strategic direction the ministry should be doing, and we are on the way to that extent.
Okay, thank you. Waleed, you have a long professional experience in PPP in this part of the world. You sit in Saudi Arabia, but you've been in Washington, you've been in Cairo, and you have operated in jurisdictions and in countries where a PPP legal framework was not well established. Can you tell us what were your major success stories and what would be your advice for Oman in this field?
Thank you. قبل أن نتحدث عن التجارب الناجحة اللي حققتها مؤسسة التمويل الدولية IFC عضو مجموعة البنك الدولي وهي المعنية بدعم القطاع الخاص أن البنية التحتية تحتاج إلى مبالغ ضخمة والحكومات تواجه تحديات كبيرة ففي الدول النامية تصل الحاجة إلى أكثر من 2 تريليون دولار وهذه التحديات ليس فقط في الدول النامية حتى الأصعب عندنا في منطقة الشرق الأوسط وشمال أفريقيا ونعتقد أن القطاع الخاص يستطيع القيام بدور هام فعملية البناء والتشغيل والصيانة تحتاج إلى مجهود ومبالغ ضخمة كبيرة وسأذكر بعض التجارب الناجحة اللي حققتها مؤسسة التمويل الدولية وسأبدأ في المملكة العربية السعودية فبدأت المؤسسة التمويل الدولية في عام 2006 كانت كأول مشروع وهو في مهام المستشار الرئيسي لامتياز مشروع مطار صالات الحجاج في مطار الملك عبد العزيز بجدة والذي استطاعت المؤسسة جمع استثمارات من القطاع الخاص بلغت 250 مليون دولار وجرى افتتاح الصالة في 2010 لتخدم أكثر من 6 مليون حاج ومعتمر ومتوقع أن يوصل العدد إلى أكثر من 11 مليون بحلول 2022 وهذه فقط الصالات وفرت على الطيران المدني في المملكة 50 مليون دولار سنوياً وفي نفسها بدأنا بوضع شراكة وطبعا قام بهذه شراكة بين مجموعة بن لادن وشركة مطارات باريس الفرنسية ADB وكذلك تولت المؤسسة في مطار الملك عبد العزيز تحلية المياه طبعا هذا المشروع كلف تقريبا 40 مليون دولار ووفر تقريبا 10 مليون سنويا على وفي وفاز في طبعا التحالفات اليونانيه لتس ومجموعه السعودي حاج علي رضا واخر مشروع قامت به المؤسسه هو مطار المدينه المنوره وكان اول مطار قطاع خاص في منطقه الخليج العربي طبعا هذا المشروع كانت تكلفته اكثر من مليار و200 مليون وكان سيكلف الدوله اكثر من ذلك ففاز في تحالف طبعا وقام بتكلفة ببنائه اللي كلفهم مليار و200 الحكومة لم تدفع ولا شيء في قيام بهذا المشروع واستطاعت التحالف اللي فاز فيه بحصول على تمويل بمبلغ 800 مليون دولار من البنوك السعودية. وسيمكن هذا المشروع من طبعاً الطلب المتزايد في المدينة المنورة وكذلك على الحجاج، طبعاً الآن في حدود 8 مليون متوقع أن يوصل إلى 15 مليون، ويكون ربح الإيرادات المتوقعة التي ستقوم بها الدولة أكثر من 50%. ففي السابق كان المطار يكلف الدولة مصاريف تقريباً تصل إلى أكثر من 20 مليون دولار، الآن سيكون هناك عوائد سنوية للدولة أكثر من 100 مليون دولار، وهذا يعني مثال ناجح لتحقيق القطاع الخاص ودوره. طبعاً هذا التحالف فاز فيه مجموعة المطارات القابضة التركية تاف ومجموعة الراجحي السعودية. هذا بالنسبة للأمثلة.
Can I ask you who was the entity that committed to yes. this? Who was the responsible for the project, the launch
اللي of فاز في التحالف مجموعة تاف وهي تركية، مجموعة تاف المطارات القابضة في تركيا، مجموعة مشغلات المطارات التركية، وتحالف مجموعة رجال الأعمال السعوديين من الراجحي، مجموعة الراجحي السعودية.
Yeah, but the entity, the who was the public
الطيران الطيران المدني يعني
civil aviation. Okay.
Yes. But this is the example of how civil aviation okay. do this. طبعاً هذكر كمان مطار الملكة علياء في الأردن، هذا يعتبر أول مطار في منطقة الشرق الأوسط وشمال أفريقيا، وهذا أول يعتبر نجاح بين القطاع الخاص والعام في هذه المنطقة. طبعاً تكلفة المشروع كانت 675 مليون دولار، وأخذ امتياز التشغيل مدة 25 سنة، وكذلك قامت المؤسسة التمويل الدولية IFC بتمويل بمبلغ 120 مليون دولار من حسابها الخاص، وجمعت مبلغ 160 مليون دولار من آخرين، وكان من ضمنهم البنك الإسلامي للتنمية شارك بتمويل 100 مليون دولار، ووفر أكثر من 23 ألف وظيفة عمل في خلال هذه الفترة. وفاز بالتحالف شركة مطارات باريس الفرنسية ADB ومجموعة مستثمرين خليجيين بهذا المطار، وحقق نجاحات كبيرة. كان في السابق يكلف الدولة مصاريف تصل إلى عشرات الملايين، أما الآن فأصبحت بدون ما كانت الدول تصرف عليه صار يحقق إيرادات للدولة.
Thank you very much for this interesting overview. Anwar, you have been on the other side. You've been dealing with governments in trying to design this PPP. What is your experience? Can you share it with us? For example, you were heavily involved with Medical City and the design of this infrastructure. Tell us what are the pros and cons, what are the positive and negative aspects.
Great. Well, I believe that the government is very, very aware of the benefits of PPP. And here in Oman, we have been a pioneer in that. Starting in 2004, I believe, no, excuse me, 1994, on power and water.
That's
so
right.
We have a very good experience on that. But recently, going to the benefits as well, other than the innovation, other than the using it as a fiscal tool or funding tool, and the benefit of knowing what you're going to be spending exactly, so that's budget certainty. There was an argument, I believe, I want to discuss it. You just raised it up in your introduction, saying that government can borrow cheaper than the private sector, and accordingly, we should expect that the PPP would be a little bit more expensive. I think that notion needs to be reviewed a little bit, considering what we have at the moment. Mm-hmm. The more the government takes debt, the higher the debt to GDP becomes, and the higher the debt to GDP entails an eventual a reduction in the rating, and this is what happened at the moment. And the recent borrowing of the government, the bond, the $6 billion bond, is actually higher. The cost of funding is higher than some of the private borrowing that could be attained in the even local market, mm-hmm. without considering the export credit agencies, that they provide a lot cheaper funding than the local at the moment. So that is usually a challenge to convince the government that you can give it to the private sector. The private sector will bring a lot of innovation, will bring in international investors, but at the same time, it might be cheaper for you than doing it yourself.
Okay,
this is one
a
of the
fair
areas.
Point, absolutely.
Yes,
yeah.
This is one of the areas. The other area, again, based on the statistics here in Oman, and outside as well, in 2013, an Australian Journal of Science conducted a study here in Oman on around 40 projects, government projects, worth around 500 million riyals. They concluded that these projects experienced around 40% cost overrun, and almost all of them experienced delays in execution. That is a big statistics, but we shouldn't be feel so bad about it, because even in the developed economies like the UK and also Canada, who are also pioneers in the PPPs, they have the almost same statistics. Over there is 30% of cost overrun. Here is around 40. So this is a very big benefit for the government to go into a PPP.
Yeah, but it is unfortunately not always the PPP leads to lower cost overrun, because it depends on the, if it's, for example, a power plant where everything is pretty much known, so the technology is known, the input cost is known, the output price is known, then the cost is pretty much always within targets. But sometimes when you have, I don't know, complex infrastructure such as an
exactly.
airport or a highway or something that has not been built and on which there is little experience, then the cost overrun, I guess it's a fact of life. So.
Exactly, and the study which was done here in Oman in sectors which are non-power and water projects. So that provides a very good argument to go into a PPP.
Okay, thanks. Dr. Amin, so what was your experience? What can you tell us about PPP in your long and distinguished professional career?
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We have heard my fellow colleagues, the distinguished panel members, on the PPP, which is in relation to building infrastructure investment, which most likely put less pressure on the private as well as on the public sectors once the partnership takes shape. In our industry, this is slightly different. And meaning to say our industry into the service industry. The service industry relates here to the tourism and the hospitality industries.
Yep.
We heard this morning from the speakers that one of the key sectors other than the industries that we know is the tourism industry. And for the piece to share, we have several facets in this sector to address as partners with the private and the public sectors. And I can list them to you, starting with a very important drive that this country, the Sultanate of Oman, is going through, the development of the tourism and the hospitality sectors. Most of the neighboring countries are shifting from addressing only the economies, their budget, from the oil being the major contributor to their GDP, and today everybody is eyeing the tourism sector. Look at Muscat Airport, look at Oman Air growth, look at the tourism of a beautiful country where we have four seasons, like the Sultanate of Oman. And I come from Lebanon, so I appreciate such basics, infrastructures for tourism development. So the private and the public sector's partnership in our business lies into several contributors. One could be addressed primarily as we move forward in the Sultanate of Oman and in other countries, is the know-how that international companies bring in. The second important one is the nationalism, the nationalization, which means the Omanization. The commitment that we should have as partners with the public sectors is gonna be very important in the next years to ensure that we develop the talent, we train and we develop our ladies and gentlemen into the culture of tourism, into servicing the tourism. And by doing that, we will serve all the industries that were addressed earlier by my fellow colleagues. The third aspect will be from the public sector is the legislative issues related for the private sector to partner with and to have, for instance, hotel classification and to bring in such know-how to the local marketplace. And we have witnessed that in many years throughout the region. One more aspect is the technology that international groups that the private sector brings in to the marketplace in terms of the easy access and knowledge and acquisition of their experience in any technological approach to what they provide. What is important is to realize the fact that what is our plan to contribute to the GDP of the country once we develop such easement in terms of partnership at all levels of contributors from the hospitality providers as private sector to the public sectors with all their logistics, infrastructure, and what the country offers. Thank you.
Many thanks. I want to start again from this side of the panel. Hussam, the question in everybody's mind is focused on the new law on PPP, which is currently under discussion or under consideration. But more generally, how do you see what is needed for Oman in order to set up a good framework for public-private partnerships.
Yeah. So what I've heard so far has been very interesting insight, practical as well as at a theoretical level. What I would say is that we need to adopt a methodology where, you know, it's horses for courses. So rather than one size fits all, our friend Anwar, I think, alluded to the speciality or the specificity of the power and water sectors. What might work there may be challenging in other sectors. And I think the country, we in Oman, face this challenge of finding the model that works for the different sectors. So, you know, with tourism, there may be a specific model. Another one with health, and I don't think we need to start from scratch. You know, we probably can build from our experience, because we in ISFU deal with various parties, so we tend to basically be, if you like, a collecting pot of information. And what we found is that indeed the Sultanate has had quite a lot of learnings when it comes to PPP. If you talk about the oil sector, the oil and gas sector, a lot of investments there. If you talk about the power sectors, so what does that mean for the rest of the other sectors? One of the challenges is indeed what has been mentioned, and that is the transfer of knowledge or the transfer of technology, and specifically how to operate technology, because if you invite a foreign entity to come and invest in a major project, say, you know, with electricity, then what you're essentially doing, you are gaining a lot of advantages, like you've mentioned earlier on, and like it has been mentioned. At the same time, you are not creating a public electricity company that is Omani, which has been the model in other countries, and that's fine in itself. That's not an issue. What we need to ensure is that indeed the transfer of knowledge goes on, so that strategically we are not affected.
What can I add, especially? I think it's not a matter of having a law or having a strategy, as more as really having four things. First of all, to have really a long vision, why we need it. Is it really to solve our problem now? If that's our aim, then I think this is not a good idea to have it. So first of all, we need really as a government to have a long vision of this PPP, and what is it as an aim or as a tool? Is it an enabler, or it's really an aim that for the government? The second thing, we need resilient system. It's I think if we are only buying, especially in some fields like health, education, and others, and we are still our systems and infrastructure is not there. Still the governance and stewardship is not there, then we need really be very cautious on that. The third thing, I think what we need to is really to have empowerment of the community itself. The community, especially in some fields, they always still we have the culture that the government, if I talk about the health, that the government is the leader. Government is the provider. So that's what we are doing now, especially in health, that to prepare our community in the phase, the coming phase, in which we have this partnership and so on. And the last thing, what we need really, as we believe PPP is really a very important issue, is to have a well-defined roles. We need to revisit what is the role of government, especially in the essential services like health, education, and so on. So we should have a well-defined roles of the government and the private, Without this, we will face like what other countries are facing in these areas, that instead of going to that, they come back to like government again, mm-hmm. and so mm-hmm. on. So mm-hmm. these are should be there before applying any model or any sub-model of the PPP.
Very thanks. And Walid, I would like to ask you, you have such a wealth of experience. In your view, what is the best practice that a country like Oman could look at, could learn from, could adopt? Maybe if you can make differences between sectors, you know, health, education, transport, whatever. Give us your view on what model could be suitable or relevant for us.
Okay, just to add first to my colleagues about the importance of the law. Also, I mean, we see it in many countries that they have a center for privatization or department or a ministry mm-hmm. for this to focus in privatization. Also, you can do privatization.
Which countries are these?
Sorry?
Which countries are...
I mean, I give you an example. In Saudi, we have a center mm-hmm. for privatization. In Egypt, we have a department
okay.
in the government, only focus on PPP. And also, we could do, I mean, you could also do privatization and PPP without the law. You don't need to wait for the law. And we have a lot of experience and successful stories. As mentioned, for example, we started in Saudi Arabia in 2006, and there is no law at that time, and in other countries. And I mean, if you see, for example, your second question about Oman or GCC, now the infrastructure need a lot of source, mm-hmm. and the country alone cannot do it.
Of course,
I mean,
of course.
It's not only building, it's only maintenance, also continue to make it working for the future. You need to have the private sector. And to make private sector involved, you need, one of them, it's involved through the PPP. But I think it's involving the private sector, also especially for international. International, they look for a country for the big project and infrastructure, and they want to do an infrastructure.
Sure.
And I think Oman and what we are seeing now, a lot of infrastructure has been done, like the new airport, the roads around, the infrastructure. It's very important. My deputy here mentioned about the health. The health, we have a country that have an experience in health for water also, it's very important. And things that I think Oman also needed is the solar. I mean, mm-hmm. The cost of the government subsidy, the power, it is high. Involving solar, it could help a lot. I mean, we saw in GCC and the region how the price of solar go down. It will become very attractive. Plus, the environmental effect also. The environment
mm-hmm, yes.
affected also for solar.
But just to add to your comments, it's true that all over the world, money is not an issue. Because you have pension funds, funds of all sorts, and savers who are looking for the opportunity to invest in infrastructure which give relatively stable yield for the long term. The challenge is to provide projects that the investment committee of a pension fund or of a large fund can approve because it's well designed, has all the right parts in place. But I mean, I think it if you see that there is no need for a PPP law per se, then I would take you your words and invite the IFC to come to Oman and help us to maybe break the ground on some key project, because definitely we would benefit from the know-how that you have accumulated over decades, and this dialogue and this interaction could be very, very, very fruitful. Anwar,
just to add, I agree with you, But also, you know, to build the project with PPP, it takes time.
I know.
We have an experience take between at least some that take at least 2 years mm-hmm. to build, to put things in place legally. Due diligence, things take so much time.
I know.
And
I know.
Once the government start and see the benefit of it, will continue. And hopefully, I mean, we could start and work closely with the Ministry of Finance here in Oman, and to find the project that it also could be attractive to the pensions, to attractive to international, to local, to regional investor to come. Absolutely. And invest there.
It's a learning curve, and the first time it's always very testing, very challenging. Then you learn, you bank on the experience, you build, and it becomes speedier. But definitely somebody has to do the heavy lifting. And for example, we at OIF have tried in several occasions and on several sectors to do this heavy lifting. And it has been a very tough challenge, and Anwar was at the forefront of this. So maybe Walid was mentioning the renewable, and you also tried to break the ground on this field. Can you tell us what should be done, what can be done in order to pave the way for a large renewables industry in Oman? Through PPP?
Through PPP. I like to cover the regulations as well, because this is very, very
sure,
important.
Sure. No, go ahead, please.
There is a perception that we have to establish the unit to start the PPP program, but actually not. We have been pioneered, as I said, with OPWP managing the power and water. And also, the government has a tool that has been interacting with the private sector, the regulation on the BOOT, build, operate, and transfer. This has been in existence for many years, and this is a tool where you can interact with the private sector. So actually, currently, you don't need the unit, okay, to begin any PPP.
Okay.
To me, you need a unit to be enacted immediately, to be the intermediary between the private sector uh-huh. and the government sector, with all the expertise built in the unit to assist the government entities to examine these projects and take them either through a PPP or on a conventional procurement process. Through my experience in study and analysis on this, I believe that every capital expenditure or project can be done actually through a PPP.
Sure.
In one structure or another, but with the different degrees of benefits.
Mm-hmm.
So with that, if we have a PPP unit that can examine every single capital project that is done by the government and decide immediately that these projects will be done through a PPP and tender them, I think we will go through a fast track.
Okay, so you're saying, if I can summarize, we don't need necessarily to change drastically the legal framework.
No.
More or less, everything is already in place. What we need is a one-stop
exactly.
shop where we can go and say, here what we want, this is what we need, this is what the country needs, let's see if the PPP makes sense. If so, let's move and let's involve the private sector.
Exactly. In just to give you an example, through a PPP unit in Canada, every project, every government capital project that is done by them, it has have a threshold of 100 million and above have to go through a PPP analysis.
Checkup.
Yeah, checklist.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, they'll decide whether it is tendered through a PPP or done through a conventional procurement process.
That's very interesting. Yeah. That's very interesting. Doctor, What do you want to add to in this area?
I wouldn't agree more to have a one-stop shop when we talk investment, especially when we develop hospitality project, touristic destinations, mm-hmm. because this entails many trades and many governmental departments, ministries and institutions. I would like to emphasize on a very important element of the PPs together, very important, and I would like to also say it in Arabic. I think the Arabic language is also pretty well descriptive and expressing it, which is تحفيز النمو الاقتصادي في جميع المناطق, to incentivize the growth, the development, the economic development in all areas, in the muhafazat, in the wilayat, as we call it. And I would like to give an example. 15 years ago, we opened the hotel, and thanks to one of the great supporters of the tourism industry in this country, who I believe is present with us, Mr. Mohsen Belushi, His Excellency here with us, when we developed the first hotel in Musandam, in Khasab, and we have sold, we promoted the destination. And that was a strong partnership that was, if you will, identified between the private and the public sector. And this moved forward to other projects as well. What is important also, I would like to emphasize here is, again in Arabic, سرعة التحرك للمنافسة الإقليمية. The country also has a great deal of uniqueness. You know, عندنا مميزات جميلة جدا ومهمة جدا وما حدا عنده مثلها في عمان. كما كل دولة في إلها مميزات. عندنا بالسلطنة مميزات مهمة جدا. وهالمميزات هيدي بتخلينا نكون مختلفين عن غيرنا. So we can capitalize on it to grow also under the one-stop shop, and then to have these incentivized issues for the tourism and for the hotels. What is also important to complement that, and before I finish, is دائما السعي لخلق بيئة ومناخ جاذب للاستثمار. This is very important to have periodic reviews, periodic workshops between both sectors to do that, which will lead us to the legislative matters that should be taken into consideration, what the private sector is motivated by their investment.
Thank you very much. I would like to close this this panel, and you know, invite you to join us for lunch. Before doing that, though, join me in giving a round of applause to our speakers. They have been very, very useful in explaining their views, and you know, I want to thank them on my behalf and on behalf of the organizers. Thank you all.